Today we will discuss the remaining part of unit number first. So the content of today lecture is basically pass structure of a compiler. After that we will discuss about the cross compiler and bootstrapping, and at the last we will discuss about the compiler construction tools. So we will move towards the pass structure of the compiler. Basically, what do you mean by pass? So before thinking about the pass structure of a compiler, we have to learn an idea what is the pass. So a pass means one complete scan of a source program or its equivalent representation. It includes reading an input file and writing an output files. Basically, in implementation point of view of the compiler, the portion of one or more phases are combined into the module that is called the pass. So whenever we will scan a source program and represent it into the equivalent representation, so this phenomena, reading and writing of a program or its equivalent representation, is called pass. If we will move towards the example, so a simple and modular way of implementing a compiler based on the model is as shown in particular figures. Here source program is given to the synthetic analysis. Synthetic analysis will generate a struct tree that will be work as an input for the semantic analysis. Semantic analysis will perform the certain task of adding data types, and the syntax tree is converted into the decorated abstract syntax tree. After that, we will feed this abstracted syntax tree, or you can say annotated parse tree, into the intermediate code generation phase. That will generate the intermediate code. Code optimization will be performed on the intermediate code by the code optimization phase, and we will get intermediate code, and that intermediate code is passed to the target code generation phase, and machine code or the target code get generated. So in this implementation, each phase is worked as a modules with input and output as specified inside the particular figures. Here you can see input is the source program, output is the abstract tree. Input is the abstract tree for the semantic analysis, and output is the decorated abstract tree. Input for the intermediate code is the abstract syntax tree, which is decorated, and output is the intermediate code. After that, this particular intermediate code get fed into the code optimization phase, and optimized intermediate code is a output. So these are the equivalent representations, right, of a source program. If you will think source program will be here, then remaining part is the equivalent representation. So each phase takes the source program or its equivalent representation and convert them into the another representation. So reading, here this is the reading, and here this is the writing. So reading and writing of a source program or its equivalent representation is called pass. So now we will think in this particular implementation, each modules did this particular task, which takes the input program or the equivalent representation as an input and perform the conversion, right? So here if we will move towards the depth, so lexical analysis modules will take the source program and scan it and break it up into the tokens, and output is the stream of tokens as an intermediate files. The syntax analysis modules similarly takes the entire list of tokens and create a parse tree that is represented the entire source program. After that, semantic analysis modules would take the parse tree as an input and perform type checking and annotate it with the data types information. Similarly, intermediate code generation phase, code optimization phase, code generation phase, where each modules transform the input and gives an output in accordance to the previous figures I have discussed. So in this representation, each of the modules runs through an input representation of the entire source code in some form and creates the output representation of the entire source program in same or the different form. So each time we read थ्रू अ रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द इंटायर सोर्स प्रोग्राम वी टर्म इट एज अ पास. सो दिस टाइप ऑफ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन वेयर वी रीड थ्रू अ रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द इंटायर सोर्स प्रोग्राम मल्टीपल टाइम्स इज कॉल्ड द मल्टी पास कंपाइलर्स वेयर मल्टीप्लिसिटी ऑफ द रीडिंग एंड राइटिंग ऑफ द प्रोग्राम्स विल बी देयर. सो गोइंग बाई दिस अप्रोच ऑफ हैविंग अ पास फॉर ईच फेजेज इन द प्रीवियस फिगर आई हैव डिस्कस्ड वी वुड हैव अ सिक्स फेज कंपाइलर्स राइट. सो सिक्स फेजेज वर्क एज अ पास और वर्क एज अ मॉड्यूल. सो दिस कंपाइलर इज ऑल्सो नोन एज द सिक्स पास कंपाइलर्स. हियर अनदर वे ऑफ द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ अ कंपाइलर बेस्ड ऑन द मॉड्यूल्स दैट इज ऑन इन द नेक्स्ट फिगर इन विच बी क्लब सर्टेन फेजेस इन टू द वन पास. लेट्स से यू कैन सी दिस पर्टिकुलर फिगर हियर वी कैन मर्ज लेक्सिकल एनालिसिस सेंटेक्स एनालिसिस सिमेंटिक एनालिसिस एंड इंटरमीडिएट कोड जनरेशन इन टू द सिंगल मॉड्यूल्स. आफ्टर दैट वी कैन मर्ज द कोड ऑप्टिमाइजेशन एंड कोड जनरेशन फेज इन टू द एनोदर मॉड्यूल्स. सो दिस पर्टिकुलर फिगर शोज यू यू विल गिव्स द सोर्स प्रोग्राम हियर आफ्टर परफॉर्मिंग वेरियस टास्क एज पर एज द रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ द वेरियस फेजेज. फर्स्ट कोड इज रिटन हियर, फर्स्ट इंटरमीडिएट फाइल इज रिटन हियर, नेक्स्ट मॉड्यूल टेक्स दिस पर्टिकुलर फाइल्स एंड प्रोड्यूस द आउटपुट कोड हियर. सो यू कैन सी रीडिंग एंड राइटिंग ऑफ अ पर्टिकुलर प्रोग्राम इज कॉल एज अ पास. तो हाउ मेनी पासेज आर हियर, रीडिंग फ्रॉम हियर, राइटिंग फ्रॉम हियर, रीडिंग फ्रॉम हियर एंड राइटिंग फ्रॉम हियर. सो दिस इज अ पास वन एंड दिस इज अ पास टू. सो दिस इज अ गुड एग्जाम्पल ऑफ अ पास टू कंपाइलर्स. हियर वी कैन रीड द टोकन्स थ्रू द लेक्सिकल एनालिसिस फेज. इफ द टोकन्स यू कैन मैचेज टू द ग्रामर रूल्स देन यू हैव टू गो फॉर द स्टेप नंबर थ्री, एल्स यू हैव टू गो फॉर द स्टेप नंबर वन. दिस पर्टिकुलर टास्क इज कॉल्ड द सेंटेक्स एनालिसिस. इन स्टेप थ्री वी विल परफॉर्म द सिमेंटिक चेक फॉर द मैच्ड ग्रामर एंड कंस्ट्रक्ट द सिमेंटिक एनालिसिस राइट. After that, we will generate the intermediate code for the matched grammar constructs. So this particular phenomena is called the intermediate code generation. So we can repeat the sequence 1, 2, 4 in the above until the entire input source program is completely read. In this case, lexical analysis, syntax analysis, semantic analysis and intermediate code generation are performed in a single pass because there is a single file read which is the source program, and after execution of the source program through the all the four phases, lexical analysis, syntax analysis, semantic analysis and intermediate code generation, we will get a intermediate code generated intermediate file. So complete scan of a program means writing of the reading and writing of the files will be take place once. So this is a one pass. Similarly, if you will move, the control here is alternating among these phases in this particular implementation. So the interface among each of these phases would be implemented by the implementation, you can say programmer's choice. However, the output of the complete pass remains as a intermediate code files in this case. Figure shows a two-pass compiler design where we have clubbed the lexical, syntax, semantic and intermediate code generation into the single pass and have a pass for the rest of the phases. Typically, you can say code optimization and code generation phase require a separate pass. Why it is required a separate pass? Because in case of the optimization of intermediate code, entire code will be required. So multiple instructions will be involved. Because to find out the dead code, to find out the unreachable code, etc., will be possible only if we have a entire intermediate code representation of a source program. So due to that, we can make code optimization and code generation phase as a different modules, or you can say escape from the remaining first pass of a compiler, first module of a compiler. So, due to that, it is called the two-pass compiler. बट व्हाट्स अबाउट द वन पास कंपाइलर्स? सो इन थ्योरी इफ वी एलिमिनेट द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ द ऑप्टिमाइजेशन, राइट, इफ वी एलिमिनेट ऑप्टिमाइजेशन देन इट इज पॉसिबल टू हैव अ सिंगल पास और अ वन पास कंपाइलर फॉर सम ऑफ द प्रोग्रामिंग लैंग्वेज. सो इन वन पास कंपाइलर वन सोर्स लाइन इज स्कैन, टोकन्स आर आइडेंटिफाइड, सेंटेक्स ऑफ द लाइन इज एनालाइज, सिम्बल्स आर पुट इन टू द सिम्बल टेबल, सिमेंटिक एनालिसिस इज परफॉर्म फॉर द चेकिंग करेक्शंस, आफ्टर दैट इंटरमीडिएट कोड जनरेटेड एंड देन टारगेट कोड इज जनरेटेड. सो दिस सेम प्रोसेस इज रिपीटेड फॉर ईच लाइन ऑफ द कोड अंटिल द इंटायर प्रोग्राम इज कंप्लीटेड. सो यू विल फेड द सोर्स प्रोग्राम हियर एंड यू विल गेट द टारगेट कोड, राइट. So source program is directly converted into the target code. There is no intermediate file in between all the phases because we eliminate here code optimization that require the complete program to perform the optimization. So if optimization phase is not there, you can directly generate the code, or you can say you can perform the pipelined manner line by line. Various transformation and at last you will return the target programs. So there is only one input program and one output programs, right? So here you can read, here you can write. So the number of passes is one, right? Now we will move towards the what is the advantage and disadvantage of the single pass and the multi-pass compiler. So whenever we will think single pass compiler is fast. Why it is fast? Since all the compiler code loaded into the memory at once, so it can process the source text without overhead of the operating system to close one process and start another. Basically, operating system takes the responsibility to load the various phases into the main memory to perform their task. So this overhead can be eliminated inside the single pass compiler. Why? You can say simple term, all complete compiler is required in a single pass. That's why we can save our times because it is fast in the executions. Second, a single pass compiler takes more space than the multi-pass compilers because all of the phases are placed into the main memory in case of the single pass compiler. But in case of the multi-pass compilers, the memory is repeatedly used by another phases. Means whenever a particular phase is required, it is loaded into the main memory. When its task gets completed, it is swept towards the secondary memory and another phase get uploaded into the main memory to do their task. So in this manner, you can reuse the memory in case of multi-pass compiler. But in case of single pass compiler, you can simply put it down the entire compiler inside the memory. So it will require a large memory, huge memory, right? So in short, we can say the memory is less, then you can use the multi-pass compiler. On the other hand, if computer have a large memory, then you can simply use the single pass compiler or the compiler with the fewer pass. Basically, in practice, compiler designed with the idea of keeping the number of passes as minimum as possible. So the number of pass required in a compiler to process the input source program depends on the structure of a particular programming language. Compilers for some programming language like C can be implemented by the single pass or the two pass, while PL/L or you can say ALGOL 68 compiler cannot be implemented in a single pass. The language like PL/L or ALGOL 68 allows variables to be used before the declaring them, right? So this makes hard to design a single pass compiler for them, since the semantic analysis cannot be performed without the knowledge of the variable types. The other factors that affect the construction of the single pass compiler are the forward referencing as well as the optimization. So now we will think about the what is the forward referencing. Basically, you can see here, I have written a code inside this particular snapshots, that code tells you we have used go to jump, and here I have defined a label jump, right? So what is the meaning? If x is equals to y, then go to jump, right? And jump will construct contain this particular instructions. So what is the meaning? If the single pass compiler is there, right, what happens whenever you will convert it into the machine code, right, what happens? It tells you go to the jump, right? And jump will not generated or translated into the machine code. So the address of the jump is not available. Means it will forward you to the particular label to whom address is not generated, right? So this problem can be occurred inside the single pass compiler. In short, we can say the statement go to jump cannot be compiled in one pass, since the address of the label jump cannot be determined while compile it. So this problem can be solved by having two pass compiler in which one pass a single pass we can allocate the storage, and in the second pass we can generate the target code for that. Another techniques that will be popularly used nowadays, that is called the backpatching, where statements holes are left until the information is not available. So by the help of the backpatching or by the help of a two pass compiler, we can solve the problem. In two pass compilers, first pass we can allocate the storage, and second pass we will generate the code in target code. Or you can simply left the holes for the addresses that is not available. That phenomena is called the backpatching. Now optimization in case of a single pass compiler is done line by line, right? It is not performed on the entire source program. So this is also a big drawback of a single pass compiler. Basically, whenever the complete program is not available, the optimization is not performed in a better way. So in case of single pass compiler only, we can perform the optimization line by line. So optimization on the line is have a limited scope, but if the entire program is available, then optimization must be better. So this is a drawback of a single pass. You can perform only optimization in form of the line by line, entire program is not available. Now we will move towards the another topic, that is called the cross compiler. And there is another terminology related with the cross compiler, that is called the bootstrapping. So question is that what is the cross compiler? A cross compiler means a compiler that runs on a platform and capable of generating executable code for the another platform, right? So a compiler like Java that will run on a particular machine A, generate the code that will run on the machine B, right, is called the cross compiler. The various examples of a cross compiler is a number of mini and micro computers compilers are implemented in such a way that they run on the bigger machine, and output produced by them acts as a object code for the smaller machines. So the cross compiler techniques basically facilitate us the platform independence. How it will facilitate the platform independence? Basically, it will facilitate the platform independence in this manner. It will generate the code that will run on another machine. So if platform is independent, right, you can run the target that is produced by the one compiler onto the another machine. So platform independency will be there. After that, what is the bootstrapping? Basically, whenever we will think about the bootstrapping, I ask you, a C compiler run over the Unix, right? You can think of, and Unix is written in C. So which comes first, right? Samajhiye, C compilers written this run over the Unix environment, and Unix environment is written in C. So which comes first? Either Unix operating system comes first or the C compiler comes first. So the solution of this question is given by the bootstrapping, right? So bootstrapping is a process in which a simple language is used to translate more complicated programs, which in turn may handle for more complicated programs. So this complicated programs can be further handle even more complicated programs, and so on, right? A good example of the bootstrapping is I will relate it with the operating system booting. What is the booting? You have turned on the power. After that, the essential features uploaded inside the RAM by the help of ROM, right? Those essential features once again takes other features from the hard disk to the main memory. So in this way, complete operating system get uploaded in your computers or working on your computers. Firstly, main features. After that, remaining alternative features. Those remaining alternative features push up the remaining alternative features, and in this way, the operating system comes into the working condition, right? Similarly, writing a compiler for any high-level language is a complicated process. So it takes a lot of time to write a compiler from scratch. So here, a simple language is used to generate the target code in some stages. To clearly understand bootstrapping technique, consider the following scenario. Let us think a particular compiler is characterized by three languages. Here, the first language is the source language, second language is the target language, and third language is the implementation language. What is the meaning of that? Here, we will think a compiler is written or compiler can be mathematically depicted by the help of a three language. First one is the source language, second one is the target language, and third one is the implementation language, right? Source language is the language to whom programs compiler get accepted, right? Or you can say source language is the language in which you can write the programs for the compilation. Or you can say input programs are written in the particular language. That language is called the source language. Target language is the language in which source program get converted by the compiler, right? So third one is the implementation language. So implementation language is a language in which compiler written itself, right? The language of a compiler is called the implementation language. Next, if we will think these three languages, mathematically we can define the compiler in form of the T diagrams, right? So this T diagrams, we can also say it Tom Stone diagram. Right? So from that Tom Stone, I have stolen T here to represent it. So by the help of the T diagrams, we can represent a particular compilers in which T diagrams, right? You can say this is a T, this is a source language which compiler takes as an input. This is a target language in which compiler produces the code or convert the source program, right? Here is the I, in which the particular compiler is written, right? In which the particular compiler is written. So the particular Tom Stone diagrams, sometimes it is also called the cross compilers. So in textual form, it can be represented as S, I, subscript and T, right? S, I, T. S and T are at same level, and I is the subscript, right? और समटाइम्स यू कैन ऑल्सो राइट सी कंपाइलर एस टी एंड आई, राइट? सो वी कैन समटाइम्स रिटन इन दिस मैनर, राइट? वी कैन ऑल्सो रिटन इन दिस मैनर. दिस इज अ कंपाइलर्स, इट इज अ सोर्स लैंग्वेज, इट इज अ टारगेट लैंग्वेज, इट इज अ इंप्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज. सो राइट अ क्रॉस कंपाइलर फॉर अ लैंग्वेज एल इन इंप्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज एस टू जनरेट द कोड फॉर मशीन एन, राइट? बाई द हेल्प ऑफ बूट स्ट्रैपिंग वी वॉन्ट टू राइट डाउन अ क्रॉस कंपाइलर. लेट्स वंस अगेन अंडरस्टैंड दिस पर्टिकुलर टर्म. वी वॉन्ट टू राइट अ कंपाइलर फॉर द लैंग्वेज एल इन द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज एस टू जनरेट द कोड फॉर मशीन एन, राइट? सो वट इज द मीनिंग? मीनिंग इज दैट इट टेल्स यू द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज हियर इज एस, सोर्स लैंग्वेज इज एल. वी वॉन्ट टू राइट अ क्रॉस कंपाइलर फॉर द लैंग्वेज एल, राइट? सो सोर्स लैंग्वेज इज एल, आफ्टर दैट इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज इज एस, एंड टारगेट लैंग्वेज इफ द पर्टिकुलर प्रोग्राम्स विल बी प्रोड्यूस्ड फॉर द मशीन एन, सो द कोड विल बी फॉर द एन. सो टारगेट लैंग्वेज इज एन हियर. सो इफ आई वॉन्ट टू राइट डाउन इट इन टू द फॉर्म ऑफ शॉर्ट हैंड नोटेशंस, हाउ कैन आई राइट इट? एल एन सोर्स लैंग्वेज, राइट? आफ्टर दैट यू कैन से टारगेट लैंग्वेज, हियर इज द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज, राइट? सो एग्जिस्टिंग कंपाइलर फॉर द एस रन्स ऑन अ डिफरेंट मशीन एम एंड द जनरेट द कोड फॉर एम, राइट? मान ली सपोज एग्जिस्टिंग कंपाइलर्स अवेलेबल फॉर द मशीन पर्टिकुलर लैंग्वेज एस दैट विल बी रन ऑन द मशीन एम एंड प्रोड्यूस द कोड फॉर द सिमिलर मशीन एम. सो द कंपाइलर फॉर दैट विल बी रिटन इन विच फॉर्म? एस इज अ सोर्स लैंग्वेज, राइट? एम कोड इज प्रोड्यूस्ड बाई दैट पर्टिकुलर कंपाइलर एंड रन ऑन मशीन मीन्स इट इज रिटन ऑल्सो रिटन इन एम, राइट? सो दिस इज द अवेलेबल कंपाइलर फॉर यू. यू हैव टू थिंक एट बी वॉन्ट टू ड्रॉ, बी वॉन्ट टू डिजाइन, बी वॉन्ट टू कंस्ट्रक्ट अ कंपाइलर फॉर द लैंग्वेज एल, राइट? विच प्रोड्यूस द कोड फॉर मशीन एन एंड हुज इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज इज एस, राइट? एंड एग्जिस्टिंग कंपाइलर इज अवेलेबल दैट रन्स ऑन मशीन एम, राइट? इफ इट रन्स ऑन मशीन एम देन द टारगेट कोड विल बी एम, राइट? एंड प्रोड्यूसेस द कोड वंस अगेन फॉर एम. सो द कंपाइलर कन्वर्ट द सोर्स प्रोग्राम इन टू एम एंड इट इज यूज टू कन्वर्ट द सोर्स प्रोग्राम ऑफ एस लैंग्वेज. सो यू कैन से एस इज अ सोर्स, एम इज अ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज एंड जनरेटेड कोड फॉर एम. सो एम इज अ टारगेट, राइट? सो वी विल गेट टू कंपाइलर्स. फर्स्ट वन इज दिस, वी वॉन्ट, राइट? डिजायर्ड कंपाइलर. दिस इज अ अवेलेबल कंपाइलर. दिस वन इज द अवेलेबल कंपाइलर. सो बाई यूजिंग द बूट स्ट्रैपिंग हाउ कैन बी कन्वर्ट इट? यू कैन सी आई हैव यूज द एग्जिस्टिंग कंपाइलर. दिस वन एस इज अ सोर्स लैंग्वेज, एम इज अ जनरेटेड कोड एंड एम इज द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन लैंग्वेज. वी हैव रिटन द प्रोग्राम इन एस हुज इनपुट इज एल एंड आउटपुट इज एन, राइट? वट इट विल डू दिस कंपाइलर? दिस पर्टिकुलर कंपाइलर विल कन्वर्ट दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोग्राम, राइट? दिस इज अ कंप्लीट प्रोग्राम, यू कैन सी, एंड रिटन इन एस, राइट? वेयर इनपुट एंड आउटपुट डजेंट मैटर. Meaning is that when you have to write down the C program, right? And input and output may be a file reading or a console, means keyboard reading, etc. So there is no matter. The C compiler will convert the C program into the target program, right? Assembly code. Similarly here, if the complete program is written in S, so what is the input, what is the output, there is no matter. It will simply convert this S program into the M program. Because the target code is M, so simply it will produce the m program in this format whose input and output may must be similar, right? Whose input output must be similar. There is no matter in input output. Only things is that to which language it is written. So S language is written, or the compiler of S language is already available for with us. So S compiler takes the S program, right, and convert it into the M program, right? So available particular compiler is L, N, and M. It will produce the code for M, right? What is the meaning of it? The meaning of it is, it will takes the source program in form of language L, produces the code for the language for the machine N, or the target language is N, and run on machine M, right? So compiler run on machine M, take the source program in form of L language, and produces the code for the N machine, right? N machine. So it is a cross compiler, right? It is a cross, means it will produce the code for the another machine. So it is a cross compiler. Now we want to construct the compiler for the N machine that will run on N machine and produces the code for N machine. So how it will take place? We will take the available compilers, right? So you can see here, from here you can see, firstly we will think of this. We will construct the compiler that will run on machine. Basically you can see here, we have a compiler that will takes the source program in L, produces the code for machine N, and run on machine M, as we have seen previously, right? Now by using this particular compiler that will run on machine M, you have written another compiler that will be in language L, right, whose input and output are similar, right? Whose input and outputs are similar to L and N. We are not thinking about the input output. You want to construct the compiler for a particular source language and particular target language, you have to write down it. But it is available till now. The particular compiler which takes the source program in L language, produces code in N language, and run on machine M. So you have to run it on machine M. After that, what you have to do? Once again, you have to write the compiler, same compiler, in language L. What it will do? It will convert the complete program into the N program, right? Because the target language is N, right? You can see here, the target language is N. Input and output is similar to the source program, right? There is no change. I have already discussed with you. So this compiler get produced by this particular cross compiler. Now you can see, it will takes the source program in N language, right? L language, and after that it will produce the target code in N language, and implementation language is also N. So it will run on the machine N. So now you can get a particular compiler which run on machine N and produces the code for that particular machine. So this particular combined phenomena, cross compiler generation, after that the compiler for the another machine generation, is called the bootstrapping. Suppose we want to produce the compiler for the same language, how it get produced for the same machine? If I have a L language compiler available, which will produce the code in M language, and whose implementation language is M, means the compiler will run on the machine M. Implementation means run on the particular machine. So this particular compiler run on machine M, takes the source program in L language and produces the target program in M language. So once again, we want to construct a compiler which run on the particular machine M and produces the another machine. So this is a simple term, right, by which you can do this particular task. The complete diagram will be looks like this one. First one is this availability of the compiler, particular language L. M produce the code in a language M, implementation is M. You have you want to generate a compiler for language L, which will run on the machine N as well as whose target language is N, right? That is completely dedicated for n machine. So firstly, you have to written the program, compiler program in L language. It will produce, it will convert this L program, right, into M programs, right? After that, input output must be same. Once again, you have to written another compiler, this one, in L language. So you get, it get converted into the N language. I have already discussed with you, and the target compiler will be this one, which run on machine N and produces the code for the same one, right? So this is a complete picture, means the two phases of the particular compiler. First one is this, second one is this, right? Here we will generate the cross compiler. After that, by the help of that cross compiler, we will generate the compiler for the another machine. Get merged into the single diagrams as follows, right? Now we will move towards the compiler construction tools. So basically, compiler construction tools are used to write down the various phases of a compiler, right? So compiler construction tools is also called compiler compilers. So the compiler writers can use some specialized tools that helps in implementing various phases of a computer or various phases of a compiler. So these tools assist in the creation of the entire compiler or its part. Some commonly used compiler construction tools are lexical analyzer generator, or you can say scanner generator. So basically, lexical analyzer generator generate the lexical analyzer. You can think of, it will not generate the stream of tokens, it will generate the program for the lexical analyzer that will be clubbed with the remaining phases of a compiler. So you have to save the time to writing down the code for the lexical analyzer. How you can scan the program, how can you produce the tokens. So nothing you have to worried about that to writing down the particular manually, right? So it will generate the lexical analyzer automatically. So here input is given in form of the regular expressions to define the various tokens of a particular programming language. After that, it will generate a finite automaton to recognize the regular expressions. Unix have a utility for the lexical analyzer generator that is called Lex. Second one is the syntax analyzer generator or parser generator. Basically, it produces the parser or the syntax analyzers from input that is based on the grammatical description of the programming language, or you can simply say grammatical description of a programming language is called the context free grammar. So input is written in form of the context free grammar for the various tokens specifications, various sentence specifications, etc., and it will produce a code for the syntax analyzer, right? That once again run by the help of a appropriate compiler produces a exe file that will takes a input in form of the stream of tokens and produces the parse tree, right? So Unix have a utility that is most popularly used to generate the syntax analyzer generator, that is called the BISCC, yuck. Third one is the syntax directed translations engine. Basically, it generates the intermediate code with three address formats from the input that consists of a parse tree. So these engine have a routines to traverse the parse tree and then produces the intermediate code. So in this, each node of the parse tree is associated with the one or more translations, right? Next, compiler construction tool is the automatic code generators. So it generates the machine language for the target machines. Each operation of the intermediate language is translated using a collection of rules. Then it is taken as an input by the code generator. A template matching process is used here. An intermediate language statement is replaced by its equivalent machine language statements using templates. And last one is the data flow analysis engines, which is used inside the code optimization. So data flow analysis is a key part of the code optimization that gathers the information that is the values that flow from one part of the program to the another part of the program. So all about this is all about the various compiler construction tools. these are the references which you can use for the enhancement of the particular topics, or you can enhance the knowledge of a particular topics by the particular references. Out of these, Aho, Sethi and Ullman is a popular one, Dragon Books. Thank you. If you have any query, you can ask.